been a blessing. You blessed us in every way, through jobs, incomes, ideals, all types of inventions. We bring unto you the resources you blessed us with. And we bring an offering as well as the tithe. We give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Let the church say amen. And God bless you. We're seated on each side of the room through the temple aisle. Amen. Beneficial to hear what Marco was sharing with me last night about an 18-year-old young man that lost his weight. Marco kind of helped him get on track, and some of the nuts and bolts that Marco gave him. I'm glad I never met Marco when he told me.
He's hard.
This is reality, amen. So who are those ladies? Sister Hill, I forgot some. Sister Denise, one of them. Okay, if you want to come on, Sister Denise?
Sister Dorothy.
Sister Dorothy, okay. And some of us missed Tuesday and Wednesday night. And they're going to share how the Lord impressed that delivery of the ministry to them and convey it to us. So let's say amen for Sister Denise.
Amen.
Nia said the revival was such a blessing, Brother Scales. I believe God added a different touch to his ministry.
That's right, yes.
Not that he hadn't been very anointed in the past, but it was just something
different.
About how God had taken him to another level. Mm-hmm. And I was just so, I was just so blessed. I was truly blessed because
Amen.
His focus was on Jesus. And sometimes, you know, yes. We get saved and we know that it takes faith and all of that. But he put a new twist on it, letting us know that
yes.
The faith that we have in God, that's Jesus, who we call
that's
our
right.
faith.
Right.
And I have been kind of pondering on this scripture, Ephesians 2 and 13, and I love this scripture. He quoted it, and it just kind of made me go back to the Word and re-familiarize myself with this verse. And it's Paul was talking about this blood that we believe God for, the blood of Jesus. And that verse is saying, as Paul ministered unto the church of Ephesus, it says, but now you who are in Christ Jesus, hallelujah, are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Hallelujah. I mean, that might not sound good to you or sound important to you, but just listen to that. But now, he's talking about now. He wrote the word many thousands of years ago.
Yes.
Ye who were afar, hallelujah, in Christ Jesus are made nigh by the blood of Christ. And it is by Jesus' blood that we all have been given, hallelujah, a different, hallelujah, outlook on life. We're given salvation. We can be healed through that blood. We can be saved and delivered. And not only that, we can receive new life through the blood of Jesus. And he went on and on. I mean, it was just so good. I mean, it
Amen.
Just made you think of the little things. And it made me think, you know, even those of us who are you know, trying to do all there is. The Bible says that the righteous scarcely be saved. Hallelujah. Worship the sinner and the ungodly appear. And we're righteous and we're doing all we know to get into heaven. The Bible says, worship the sinner and the ungodly. What shall they be? So I'm just here to encourage you and to reiterate the words that he spoke. It is now is the time that we have to give our all, saints of God. Out of the very little things, the things that you just would not think would mean much, the Lord, he puts hallelujah, high priority even on forgiveness. Hallelujah. I can't say that enough. I mean, it takes the power of Christ to allow us to forgive. And not only, you know, to forgive, but to forget that thing, and we possibly can, because Jesus said, I don't think it was Jesus, maybe one of the apostles, Paul said, if it be possible, hallelujah, he said, live peaceably with all men. Now, if he said it would be possible, then that says, oh, we're going to have some challenges. It's not always possible to forgive and love and do what the Lord said, but we have to do that because God is requiring it of us. And I'm
finished.
Thanks, God. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I was privileged to be here Tuesday and Wednesday, and it was such a rich blessing. I have to agree with Sister Hill and Sister Denise. I always enjoy Brother Scales, but it looked like to me it was just a whole nother, I mean, it was just so rich and so meaty. And I have to say it was challenging because sometimes when you're saved for such a long period of time, if you're not careful, you lose your excitement. You know, you lose your, routine, that's the word I want to use. It's routine. It's, oh, well, I got to be at Wednesday night Bible study. Oh, it's time for, but the passion.
Yes.
What I got from it, I wish I could remember a lot of what he said because there's so many. I had written a lot down and I've been studying it, so it's not in my Bible. I was really hoping, Lord, let me look deep here. But the truth is that I've been studying it, so it's not in my Bible. But he challenged us. He asked the question, who was Jesus? He said, Jesus is the Son sent from God who knew no sin. The Son sent from God who knew no sin.
That's good.
And then he said, can you have faith to believe? Sometimes he said, we're going through situations and we're saying, oh God, what am I going to do? Oh, he said, can you have faith to believe that even though you don't know what to do, can you believe that he does? And I'm telling you, these things just challenged me. Just a rich word. I guess what I would have to say, what I came away with, though, he said, Jesus is the Son of God, the Son who came from God, who knew no sin.
That's good.
And so, he said to us, now here's a man, and he was all man. He had went through the same temptations we did, but with no sin. So then his question was, so can you trust? Can you trust him? Can you trust that if he said, cast your cares, do that. If he said that I'll heal you, can you trust that he will do that? If he said, I will meet every need, can you trust? That was his challenge for me, y'all. And I'm like, Denise, I'm done.
Amen.
Oh,
okay.
You want to go ahead?
That's okay. Oh, this is good. Okay.
Just real brief.
Amen.
And I have a couple of notes. Just real brief. I'm not going to be up here long. Somebody else is bringing a message this morning, Brother Williams. It was truly a blessing to me Tuesday and Wednesday night, and it was most definitely different. Brother Scales has been coming to us for many, many years, and we have heard his messages, and I just kind of sat back and said, well, okay, I'm going to let him recap this time. I already know what he's going to say, but I didn't. And that's why we should always be open to the Holy Spirit with what the Word says. And to be able to receive the Word, regardless of who brings the Word. And it was so rich. You hear me? It was so rich. And as Sister Dorothy and Sister Denise said earlier, that he talked about, you know, faith. He talked about the life of Jesus.
Yes.
And the things that really impressed me was he talked about Jesus in terms of him having no sin. And we've been studying this in Bible study here for the last maybe 2 or 3 months. Not just two or three weeks. And our pastor has been saying, what is it that about Jesus that he had no sins? And he's our example, and we're to walk as he walks. What keeps us from doing that? And Brother Scales delineated it so beautifully the other night, and I took copious notes, and I just wanted to mention a few things he said. Since Jesus is our example, we are to, what he did was, he only did those things that the Father taught him, that the Father authorized him to do. So if we only do the things that Jesus authorized us to do, then we can walk as he walked.
Yes.
And he said he only spoke those things that his Father told him to speak. And he said Jesus always did the things that were pleasing to the Father. Now he may have had another will, and he did have another will, but he became subservient to the will of the Father. Even when he was about to go through the cross, he said, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Because he knew it was a bitter cup that he was about to partake of. But then he says, not my will, but thine be done. So if we want to walk as Jesus walked, then we have to be subservient to him, and we have to do those things that are pleasing in his sight. One other scripture, and then I'll be finished, that impressed me that he mentioned, this was on Wednesday night, Hebrews 10 and 35. Cast not away therefore your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. And he was talking about, as Sister Dorothy mentioned up earlier, sometimes we come to church, we come, okay, it's time to go to church Sunday morning, you start getting ready, Wednesday night, let me go out, and it becomes redundant, rote, and you just come because we know it's an obligation that we should be here. But there should be something on the inside. I heard the praise team singing this morning, I'm desperate for you. Lord, I am desperate for you. And when we become desperate for him, it's not, oh, I guess I'll go out. It's time to go out. You know, you're Pastor Hill, I just get. When we are desperate for him, then we are eagerly yearning to receive what he has to give us. And we find ourselves in that place where it doesn't become redundant. It doesn't become rote and we're just going through the motions because we are desperate for him. And continuing on that scripture, it says, for it has great recompense of reward, for we have need of patience that after we have done the will of God, we might receive the promise. And that's so important, that when we do the will of God, we got to have that patience. And he gave us a definition of patience, which was a little different. And I'm sure those of you that were taking notes wrote it down. We have need of patience. And that's where so many times we as Christians miss it. We've done the will of God, but we don't see things transpiring as we want them to transpire.
That's right.
And it's like, hurry up, God, and come.
That's right.
And he's saying, wait, would you wait just a little while longer? I have need to do something in your life. It may be just a slight adjustment so that when he blesses us, then we will be able to receive that blessing and we'll know what to do with it. But so many times we cast away our confidence and we say, if It's not going to happen. It hasn't happened. I've been waiting for years and nothing has happened. So I'm just going to forget it. I'm going to cast it aside. And what I want you to do today is just see where you are. And let us come to the place, as the praise team was singing this morning, where we become desperate for Him. And not that it's just a journey that we're taking, and oh, it's such a drudgery. When you become desperate for Him, it's not a drudgery. Praise God.
Amen.
And Brother Marco, and if anyone else has a testimony, feel free to share what the Lord has placed on your heart. And let's receive Brother Marco.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
This past week, I believe it was Thursday. Yeah, it was Thursday. I met this young guy. I was on a job site, you know, taking care of some things, trying to get situated and prepared for a big job we had. And when I was coming out the office, when I was coming out the building, I was going to my vehicle, and I saw this young man, about 18 years old, kind of tall guy, maybe 6'3", and he kind of flagged me down. You know, sometimes when people flag you down, you think they want some money, they want a quarter for a couple of gallons of gas or something like that. But he didn't. He just said, "Hey, excuse me, sir, do you know where the unemployment office is?" And we was downtown. I said, "I don't know." I was looking around. I said, "I didn't even know there was an unemployment office down here somewhere." And he said, "Okay, thank you, sir." So when he left, something in my spirit said, "You know what, grab that young man. He's obviously looking for a job, you know." So I had another job project he was working on later that day. And I said, "Man, where are you going now?" He said, "Well, I'm looking for an unemployment office." I said, "Okay." I said, "I'll tell you what, give me your phone number and I'm gonna call you around 11:30. Sharp." So I called him, he gave me his phone number, I called him, he answered the phone, and I said, "Hey, I got this project, you know, coming up today." I said, "If you can meet me at 12:30, sharp, you know, let me wait for you, I'll give you a shot." So I did. You know, he wasn't late to meet me there. You know, he walked from, you know, his home to where I told him to meet me. He walks everywhere. And that just touched me. I'm like, wow, this young brother, he's trying, he's needing something. Make a long story short, flunked out of college. He was a straight A student in high school. He was going to Oklahoma Baptist University or something like that. And he thought that it was going to be easy, so he was on a basketball scholarship. He, he failed out, and he owed his grandma some money and owed his school some money. He can't get back in until he paid that money off. But his grandma told him, she said, "Since you dropped out of college or flunked out, this is what I want you to do every morning. I want you to get up at 5:30 in the morning, be at my house around 6. Don't come back until 3:30 until you find a job." That's exactly what he's doing. And I'm like, man, where did he go from, you know, 6 o'clock to 3:30? I mean, that's not that much. I mean, walking, you can't look for a job that long, you know. So he just said he'd go to the day center, day center and kind of look around, look for a job, and you know, that's old school there, you know. Coming from, you know, gotta get up at 5:30, be out the house at 6, don't come back to 3:30. Man, his grandmother's teaching him that's gonna make a man out of him real quick, because he's gonna find out that that's gonna get old. So I told him, I said, "You know what? God put it in my heart to just kind of work with him alongside him. I told him to meet me tomorrow morning at 7:30. He said he's going to walk wherever I told him to meet me at. And I said, "You know, I'm going to start from here. If you do good, you know, we'll see how far it goes." But his grandmother, I talked to his grandmother the other day. She said, "Don't make it easy for him." You know, kind of sound like my grandfather. My grandfather was tough like that too, you know. But he got amazed. My grandpa, I wouldn't have been in the house at 18. I would have been living somewhere, but not there. But anyway, I just want to give the young brother a shot. He's not wanting to keep encouraging him to finish school. Don't make this a way of living. You know, it's always supplemental from here. You know, just pay your money up, pay grandma back, pay the school debts back, and get back to school. I try to encourage him to go to the to the military, you know, like the Air Force, not the Army or Navy or anything. I mean, Army or Marines, you know, the Air Force, that's probably the best thing for him, you know. He's a great young guy. I told him yesterday, he worked with me all day yesterday. Mm-hmm. I told him, I said, when you come to work, have your pants up, tucked in,
Amen.
You know, clean. I said, eat a good breakfast, and pack your lunch. You know, because we ain't going to be going to the store and all that other stuff, you know. That's the same thing teaching my grandfather taught me. You know, I forgot my lunch maybe twice. And I didn't do it anymore. You know, it was a long day for me. You know. So, you know, just basic things we need to teach these young teenagers. You know, and some of the stuff, I think I'm probably, I got some good training from my grandfather. You know, he really laid it on me. And I'm very thankful that he did that. You know, at the time, I thought he was hard and wasn't understanding. And I kind of had a flashback with this young gentleman back when I was 18 years old. It was tough. I just needed somebody to show me, show who wants, it's over with. You know, so, because I was so hungry back then. Hey, you know, you show a person, and he's desperate, he's in a good spot right now. He's going to make it,
Amen.
Or he's not going to make it. And I'm just going to give him all the, you know, information that I know. I had a long talk with God before I had my, before I started my company. I had this conversation with God. I said, if I have my own company, if I am in a position to encourage, not give, but encourage some people, that's exactly what I'm going to do. So, you know, sometimes I get a bad batch of people and, you know, kind of make me want to throw in the towel. But I said, you know, I can't stop, and won't stop. So that's what it is.
Amen.
That was very good. That was very good. I was sitting there at the table, Marcus, how shall I say, was giving that information to me. And you know, he said he met the guy downtown, and the guy was looking for an employment office. Marco didn't know. I knew what that office was. I think it's Oklahoma Workforce, is what the guy was looking for. And but Marco told the guy that, meet me at a certain spot at a certain time. Now, Marco could get in his car and say, where do you live? Well, I'll come drive you, or let's go over to, well, you know. But I was sitting there thinking, well, Marco's hard. Why didn't you just get a guy right to meet you? Now, that right there is an attitude that you call lazy. Even though it was in my mind that Marco could do that, but in a sense, Marco was putting that guy to the test to see if you're really real. And the guy had to walk, the way I perceived it, was an hour and a half to be at that location. It was 11:30?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, 11:30.
Something like that.
Okay, 11:30. He had to walk from wherever he was, point A to point B, an hour and a half, if he wanted to earn that income. Now, they don't teach you that this day. That's basically old school, right, Brother McClellan? That's pretty much old school. It's good. That's old school. And then when you come to do this job, be dressed properly. And then come with the right attitude. Now, the job doesn't pay all that much money for what, but it, what it was doing was instilling in the young man to be ready to win. Show me you want to win.
Yeah, that's right.
And the guy is 18 years old in that area. And once he gets all of that stuff instilled in him, the preliminary stuff, then he's ready to win. And Mark always talked and said, hey, you think it was hard for his grandma to put him out at 5:30 in the morning? And don't come back until 3. I said, the guy was at college. He had a dormitory, he had a bed, he had food, and he was going to school on a basketball scholarship. If he can mess that up, and then you come back and put him on a hard bed, and you got to get out of here by 6 o'clock and don't come back until 3:30, he'll be safe. I think Grandma did the right thing. And I said, I don't know how to do my son like that.
Yeah.
Oh, but that's tough love. How many have heard of that? Tough love. And I can see that 18-year-old maybe buying Marco's company from him. I can see. Marco told me the guy goes to church, he's very, he doesn't cuss, doesn't do none of that stuff. He's a Christian guy, gets up and go to church. He just goofed up in life. And you know, sometimes I don't know if I can tie that into a message or not. I think God would test you to see how serious you are about making it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Are you really serious? Are you just talking the talk? Can you walk the walk? Can you come down the plank? I think there was a man called Abraham. God did what? Tested him. The Bible says God tested him with his word. Abraham, can you believe this? Abraham, will you do what I tell you? Will you abide by the covenant? Will you agree what I got to do, what I'm saying? Will you agree? So I think sometimes God will, and if he tested Abraham, he'll still test us who we want. Love. Do you really want it? And I, you know, in the business atmosphere, the arena that I'm in, I always hear that you can't get anything for nothing. How many of you really believe that? There's a price to be paid. And sometimes you don't know the price until it's presented. Can you do it? Can you take a faster test? Okay, who wanna take those, okay? I'm through preaching, that's how benediction goes. That was great, praise God. Any other testimonies, praise God, before I get started? Oh, okay, I'll bring the evening hand on. He's gonna say, I'm gonna go Robertson.